Hey guys, in this video I will show you how to take your pandas and data analysis skills to the next level. The video will be packed with practical and valuable pandas tips. In particular, we will go over the following topics. First, we will load the dataset and do some exploratory data analysis. We will scan the dataset for missing values, plot the distribution, and check for any data correlation. Once we have a solid understanding of the data, I will show you some advanced techniques to clean up the data frame. Within the process I am about to show you, you can put the cleaning steps into a single function to keep your code organized. After cleaning the data, we will do some time series analysis before plotting the data in an interactive chart and a word cloud. Okay, and without further ado, let us get started. First things first, you need to install the required dependencies. You can grab the requirements.txt file directly from the GitHub repo or run the following cell. If you execute this cell, Python will install all required packages in your current Jupyter kernel. Once we have that out of the way, let us import the packages. We will use matplotlib, seaborn and plotly for the data visualization. I will also import skimpy to help with the data frame cleaning and wordcloud to create a wordcloud. And of course, we will also need pandas. The next cell is optional. For the sake of this tutorial, I want to display float numbers only with two decimals so that everything fits perfectly on the screen. To do that, you can run the following cell. As a next step, let us get the data and do some exploratory data analysis. The data is stored in a CSV file and hosted on my website. To convert the CSV file into a pandas data frame, you can use pd.readcsv followed by the file location. Once we have the data frame, let us look at 5 random rows. Here we have the YouTube video ID, title, publish time, how many comments the video got, the average percentage viewed, the likes, views, impressions, and the click-through rate. Overall, these are exciting insights from my YouTube channel. And to get a quick overview of the data, I typically run the info method. From this overview, we can see the different data types pandas assigned to each column. By looking at this, I can see that pandas stored the video publish time as an object. The object data type is mainly used to store text or mixed numeric and non-numeric values. However, if we look at the column, it contains date information. Later in the video, we will need to convert it to a date-time object when doing some date manipulation. With that in mind, we can also see that we have some missing values. In fact, you can run isNA on the data frame and then sum up the Boolean values. Doing so will give you a quick overview of the number of missing values by column. Sometimes it can be hard to judge whether 5 missing entries are a lot. To put things in perspective, we could also calculate the percentage of missing values by multiplying the mean by 100. This nifty trick shows that the video publish time column contains 4.7% missing values. With that information in mind, you might want to drill down to those missing entries. We can do that by using a Boolean mask. When I run this cell, pandas will return a data frame with the missing values. In my case, I have not set the following videos to public, so only people with a link can access the video. Therefore, those videos do not have a video publish time. And one of those videos has no impressions at all. Hence, there is no impression click-through rate. Okay, now that we've scanned the data frame for missing values, let us check the data distribution. To get a quick overview, we can use the describe method, which will return the following table. Personally, I like to flip the columns and rows by using the transpose method. The numbers are the same, but I think this table might be easier to read, especially when dealing with many columns. When I looked at the table, I noticed a couple of things. First of all, for the comments added, likes, views, and impression, we can see that the mean values differ widely from the median, so 50%. We will take a look at this in just a moment. Another thing I notice is that the maximum value for the average percentage viewed is over 100%. It seems some people watch that particular video over and over again. So it might be interesting to know which videos have the highest percentage viewed. We can do this by using nLargest. In my case, I will pull out the top 5 videos. I know that all of the videos are super short, They are just 1 to 2 minutes long. So I assume that people are more likely to watch a 1 minute video to the end compared to a 15 minutes long video. Okay, and with that finding, let us check the data distribution by plotting it in a histogram. To do so, I use the inbuilt pandas plotting capabilities, which uses matplotlib under the hood. When I run this cell, we get back the following histograms. Keep in mind, the purpose of those charts is only for data exploration, so I do not intend to make those charts pretty. Later in the video, I will show you how to create some stunning and interactive charts, but for now, let us focus solely on data distribution. And we can already detect that we have some outliers in our data. So those seems to be videos which have performed well in terms of the comments they received, the likes, impressions and views. Yet the impression click-through rate doesn't seem impacted by views. My typical video click-through rate seems to be around 2 to 6%. Okay, but now coming back to the outliers. You might not need data science to conclude that the more impression a video gets, the more likely you will have more views, comments and likes. To validate this assumption, you can compute the Pearson correlation of the data frame. If you run this method on the data frame, you will get an overview of how the columns correlate. But just by looking at a bunch of numbers, it is rather hard to see the most correlated columns. So you could apply some styling to your data frame and use a gradient background. By doing this, you can turn your data frame into a heat map. And as a little bonus tip, you can specify also the min and max values. If you do that, your heat map looks even better. So the way to analyze this table is that numbers closer to 1 indicate a stronger positive correlation. On the flip side, a number closer to minus 1 indicates a negative correlation. A negative correlation is a relationship between two variables in which one increases and the other one decreases. And with that, we also now have the evidence for our assumption. The comments, likes, views, and impressions are highly correlated. Another great way to generate a heat map from your data frame is to use the Seaborn library. Optionally, you could also specify the color map and the annotation format. After executing this cell, you will get back the following correlation heat map. If you want to dig deeper into the correlation and see the actual data points, you could use the Seaborn pair plot. Computing the charts might take some time, but once done, you will get the pairwise relationship for each column. For instance, let us pick the impressions and likes. We can see that the more impressions a video gets, the more likes it will have. On the other side, this doesn't apply to the click-through rate. However, those charts can be hard to read if you have outliers in your dataset. So that is why we are going to exclude the outliers. First, let me check the videos with the most views. As we can see, two videos perform much better than the rest. To exclude those, we can set an upper limit by computing the 99th quantile of the views. So in my case, the upper limit would be around 255,000 views. We can now use this number and filter the dataset before creating the pair plot. After this tweak, it is now easier to see the data points and to analyze the relationships. Okay, now that we have a solid understanding of the data, let us clean up the data frame. For the whole cleaning process, I will take advantage of the ability to chain pandas methods. So before diving into the cleaning process, let me give you an example of what I mean by this. As you might already know, you can chain pandas methods and write them all in one line, as I did here. First, I'm filtering the data frame by the views. Then I'm using a regular expression on the column name. And lastly, I am renaming one column header. If I run this cell, I get back my final data frame. This is possible because each method will return a data frame, which you can use to perform another method. Now, instead of writing everything in one line, you can also break it down into multiple lines by wrapping it in parentheses. Doing so makes debugging easier, as you can comment out certain lines. So let me run this cell, and then I will comment out the last two methods. Next, I can walk you through the steps by removing the comment. So after the query method, I'm using the filter method and the resulting data frame looks like this. And in this data frame, I will now rename the columns. Okay, and this is the basic idea of chaining different methods. And with that in mind, let me walk you through the cleaning process I have applied to this data frame. Let me print out the first rows, just so that we have a reference to what the initial data frame looks like. Next, I will comment out all methods below and delete the additional argument in my function. All left now is the function which takes a data frame as an input and returns the same data frame as an output. So when I call this function and print out the head, we will get the same result. And with that in place, let us clean up the data frame step by step. First of all, I will remove some unwanted columns. After defining the column names in a list, I can use the drop method. When I run this cell, we can see that the impressions and content columns have disappeared. Next, let us remove the none values. As you might remember, when we loaded our data frame, we noticed missing values for the video publish time and impression click-through rate. So let us now remove the empty values by using drop in A. After that, let us take care of the column headers. Because if you have empty spaces in your column header names or special characters, you might run into an issue when using the dot notation for selecting a column. To deal with that, we have imported clean columns from SkimPy. I have also a separate video on cleaning up column headers, which I will link to the info card above. With that said, let us apply the clean column function to our dataset by using the pipe method. As a result, the new data frame looks like this. Additionally, let me also go ahead and rename the impression click-through rate and the average percentage viewed to get also rid of the percentage sign. Alright, now that we have taken care of the headers, let me also make our function more flexible. For instance, in some cases, I might only want to analyze videos with a minimum of 500 views. To do so, I use the query method to filter the data frame on the views column. If you use the at symbol, you can refer to a variable inside the query method. So I have called it views threshold, which will be an additional argument in my function. And by default, I will set the threshold to 500 views. Okay, and before moving on, let me print out the data types. As you might remember, we wanted to convert the video publish time column to a date time object. We can do this by using the pandas method assign. Assign creates a new column or transform an existing one. For now, let me comment out the other operations. So what I have done here is to use a Python lambda function. I need to do it this way, as we will manipulate the intermediate state of the data frame. In particular, we want to use the toDateTime method on the video publish time. If I execute this cell, we can see that the data type has changed to a DateTime object. And this is now super useful, as we can now extract further information for the date. For instance, we can now calculate the days since I published the video. To do so, I'm creating a new column and use again a lambda expression. To get the current day, you can use today, and then I can subtract the video publish time. From the new date object, I'm only interested in the days, and I will convert those days into whole numbers by converting them to integers. So now that we have the days since published, we could put the other metrics into perspective. For instance, it might be interesting to know how many likes each video gets per day on average. To calculate this, we can create a new column and divide the likes by the total days since I published the video. Alright, and to gain even more insights from the data, I will also compute the likes to view ratio. So how many percentages of the viewers are leaving a like under the video? I have multiplied it also by 100, so that we get the result in percentage. And similar to this, let me add another column to show how many comments I get per view. Alright, and with that, we have put the whole cleaning process into a single function. So now after loading the data frame, I can simply run this function and we will get back a clean data frame, which we can use to further process and plot the data. Let us kick things off by doing some time series analysis. Therefore, let me grab our clean data frame and use the video publish time as the index. Next, I will sort the index to have a clear timeline from the oldest to the newest video. From this new data frame, I only want to analyze the views. As we only have one column selected, pandas will return a series. On this series, we can now use the plot method, and by default, we will get the following line chart. Now, the cool thing is, you can use all the powerful pandas methods like frequency conversion. For example, we can easily calculate the weekly views using resample. Yet, in some cases, I have not posted any videos for more than 1 week. Therefore, we can see some gaps in the line chart. To close those gaps, we can replace any missing values with 0. To get the average views by month, you can type m in the resample method. Now, to be fair, this is still a very simple chart. If you need a more fancy plot for your next presentation, you can use the Plotly Express library. I will not go into the details for the following function, as the main focus of this tutorial should be on pandas. But feel free to pause the video here to inspect the code. When I run this cell, we will get back this interactive line chart, and when I hover over the data points, you can get more details. Additionally, you can toggle on or off the axis. So perhaps you're only interested in the number of columns compared to the likes. And this is interesting to see. There is one video that got a lot of views, but still received fewer comments than other videos. And to see this effect even better, we have created custom columns in the cleaning process. Let us take advantage of those calculated columns and plot them in a bar chart. As before, I will not cover the details of the implementation of this chart, but feel free to pause the video here or check out the code on GitHub. After defining the function, let me print out all numeric columns of our data frame. So those are all the column names I can use in the plot column function. You can now plot the top 5 videos with the most likes. Or if you want, you can also change the number of displayed videos here. Additionally, you will get the information about the mean and median of the selected videos. So by far, one Streamlit tutorial received the most likes. And as we know, this is because it is highly correlated with the number of impressions and views that video gets. So for better analysis, we could now pick a relative KPI, like the likes to view ratio in percentage. If we plot this, the picture looks quite different. Here we can see that we have no significant outliers, so the median and mean are very close. And the number one video is another pandas tutorial, which I will also link in the info card above. If you want to present your findings to your manager, you can also export the chart to HTML using the writeHTML method on the figure object. By default, Plotly will export the chart in the current working directory. And now you have a new HTML file, which you can open in a standard browser. Okay, and last but not least, let us take all my video titles and create a word cloud out of them. And as you can see, most of my videos are tutorials about Excel, Python, Streamlit, Pandas, and VBA. So if those topics are interesting to you, consider subscribing to this channel. Thanks for watching the video and see you in the next one.